They turn on the lights and the cameras roll and the rain starts to pour while you pour out your soul. They color your hair. You have a few fears. They change a few lines while you shed a few tears. They give you the breaks. They give you the parts. So you make them all laugh and you break all their hearts. Then you do a new scene. Then again, then it's done. Her love story started. Her life has begun. That's what happens in the movie. That's what happens in the movie. Well, you clever little twinkle toes, you. Just look at you. Why did you do that to me, your best friend, huh? Why? You knew a valley like that comes along once in a career, and you wanted it, that's all. You wanted it so bad that you lied to me, your best friend, to get what you wanted. That's exactly what happened. You lied and got the valley and became a star. I got pregnant, had babies, and became a mother. And now you want to take my daughter away from me. And you say to me, but Dee Dee, I thought you'd be so pleased and thrilled that I would be willing to help Amelia become what you always wanted to become but couldn't. Wonderful. What you're really saying is you want Amelia to become like you. That's not possible. Oh, she's as good a dancer as you are. She's as talented, all right, and she works as hard. But there is one thing you are, dearest, and that Amelia, poor darling, is not and never will be. And you know what that is? You are a killer. Yes, you are. Don't you walk away from me when I say that. You're a killer. You walk over anybody to get what you want and still have a good night's sleep. That's what you did to me. You walked right over me. You killed me. You killed my chances to find out if I could dance, if I could really dance. And now you want to get your hands on my daughter. Don't you walk away from me one more time. I'm not finished talking to you yet. I just want to watch you listen to me. You're amazing. You're absolutely amazing. Look at you, the way you go on and on and on and on. You know what? You're over the hill. You're over the hill and you're terrified and you know it. All you've got, your old scrapbooks, your old toe shoes, and those stupid, dumb little dogs you travel with. But what are you going to fill in the gaps with, huh? No, my daughter! You just keep your goddamn hands off of my daughter! Fight. The director yells cut because it's finally right. Then they hand you a scene for the following day. But you don't have to fight, so it's easy to play. Then the actress you slapped lays a kiss on your cheek and says that she's off till the end of next week. That's what happened in the movie. Young lady, it is after 10 o'clock. It is time for my daughter's pain shot. She's in a great deal of pain. If you would administer... Who do I talk to? Pardon me. Young lady, it is after 10 o'clock. My daughter only has to hold out until 10, and I would appreciate... No, I don't care if she's not your patient. I would... Well, pardon me. excuse me. It is after 10 o'clock. My daughter only has to hold out until 10, you see, and she is in a great feeling. No, I am not waiting my voice. I want someone to pay some attention to this problem. My daughter is in a great deal of pain, and I don't understand why she has to have it. You get up out of that chair, and you go in that room, and you give my daughter that shot. So you get a great part, an incredible role, where you laugh and you cry, and you shatter your soul. At the end of each day, you drive home on your own. But the part that you're playing won't be your role. You get home at 10, make a big pot of tea. Your daughter is happily watching TV. She asks, do you mean that day went all right? You smile, you shrug, you kiss her goodbye. It's well after midnight, you're lying in bed. You try to forget all the lines that you've said. Yes, you try to forget all the pain that you feel. But the part that you're playing is painfully real.
Three lamps are going to be out there on the dance floor.
Thank God. It only happened in a movie.
I've got it back for me. Thank you.
Thank God. It only happened in a movie. He's real. Our illusion. That's just the way things are. Thank you. We're going to ask the question twice. You get a moment to think about your answer and then have at it. With a trade embargo agreement going between Clinton and the foreign countries this year, please give freely your consideration and feelings on the difference in pros and cons between Reagan administration and these are the questions that were given to me.
She's killed me for the question.
Give the pros and cons and your feelings on Clinton's administrative beliefs as opposed to Reagan's, the one that was
no.
Right. No. No.
Bush. I'm not in the pageant, so I don't fucking care. Reagan just sticks into mind because he never would have mentioned the word AIDS when it came out, so I'm sorry.
Is that the question?
Do you get... Do I need to repeat it one more time?
Yeah.
I'm just joking now. That is not your question. We're having a little fun with you. Well, that's when you come out and you say, I know I understand the question because I'm Cuban, but what is it that you know? Anybody in the pageant could answer it honestly. There's no right or wrong answer. Another in. But there's a right, wrong answer. Please, at this time, what advice would you give someone entering this pageant system next year? Want to be with the judges, walk to the end of the runway and give them your answer. What advice would you give someone entering this pageant system next year?
The advice that I would give to someone entering this pageant next year is to never come to a pageant unprepared. You must be prepared because you never know what's going to be in store for you up here on stage. God, it's very stressful up here, and people don't seem to understand it until they can get up here in my shoes and see why I'm looking down on all these people up here and what I have to go through to do this. It's very hard, but also, I think that if you're doing this, I think you need to take constructive criticism from anyone who's willing to give it to you. Some people won't listen, but I do, because they helped me in the long run.
Because they've worked very hard in their talents for not only this pageant, but...
Thank you.
You were? I aren't so anymore. Did your Quaalude kick in? You didn't share one with me? Oh, she's got more upstairs. I'll meet you at the question and answer. I'm going to say the question once and repeat it if necessary, and then you have time to think, and then you walk that runway and have the judges in their eyes and give them your answers, your honest opinion. I'm going to remember what the question was. Okay.
Well, the rope matches the pants.
In your own words, please give the most memorable experience of your career as a female impersonator. Oh, she doesn't need to answer quite as twice. Ladies and gentlemen, our contestant number four, question and answer, Deidre Roberts.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished panel and judges. Once again, I'm contestant number four, Deidre Roberts. The most memorable experience I've ever had doing female impersonation was when I was doing a show at another bar here in Nashville, which is closed now, that, I decided that night I would try it, not drinking one drink. That was the only time that I fell on stage. I fell so hard, it hurt for 2 weeks, and I decided just, you know, well, I've fallen, let's make real good fun of this. I ripped my wig off, I ripped my costume off, I threw my titties out. I was like, you know, let's just make this the funnest time I could have since I fell. Then I had a cocktail. Thank you.
Let me just see who she is. Who is it? Oh, hey, gal. Good luck. Love your hair. Ladies and gentlemen, put your hands together in talent competition vying for the title of National Entertainer of the Year, the fabulous Chyna. Give it up for Chyna.
Thank you. One woman.
A question and answer, please. Contestant number one, Suzanne Cain. I'm going to ask the question twice. Hand you the microphone. Is what advice would you give someone wanting to enter the art of female impersonation? Think about it. We'd like to also add that there are no right or wrong answers. You are judged on the answer that you give. Once again, what advice would you give someone wanting to enter the art of female impersonation?
Step one of my advice would be, before you enter the art of female impersonation, is you need to go out and observe the situation first. You need to go backhand stage with the girl and understand, furthermore, what she goes through, because it takes a lot to get up here and, you know, transform your entire body. Just look and observe. Furthermore, part two, take advice. A lot of advice. When I first started, I was kind of, I didn't take constructive criticism very well. And I know there's a lot of newcomers that doesn't take constructive criticism well now. And they will learn and they will grow as an entertainer when they get dissed by other impersonators that are better than they are. So furthermore, that's all I have to say. And to each and every one of you that are up and coming, my best wishes from the bottom of my heart, and God bless.
Thank you.
going to.
Because it is very nerve-wracking to be up here, to be answered a question and all that.
Okay. Just in case.
Give your honest opinion of what the number one problem is that you face as a gay man and as a female illusionist.
Thank you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm contestant number 3, Jack Stay. The biggest problem I would have to say is, considering I have no eyebrows left, and I rarely put them on when I go out, so usually I get a lot of strange looks. Some people are like, what the heck is that? But I get over it and deal with it, and I move on. And that's about the biggest problem I have. Thank you. I'm contestant number 3, Miss Jack on stage.
All right.
Hope Diamond. Give it up for Hope Diamond.
Each day I live, I want to be a day to give the best of me. I'm only one.
I love the hair. Are you?
Yeah.
I was telling you about, look. Something like that.